First Battle of El Alamein. The First Battle of El Alamein, 1 July 27, 1942, was a battle of the Western Desert Campaign of the Second World War, fought in Egypt between Axis forces, Germany and Italy, of the Panzer Army Africa, which included the Under-Field Marshal, Erwin Rommel, and Allied, British Imperial and Commonwealth, forces, Britain, British India, Australia, South Africa and New Zealand, of the 8th Army, General Claude Auchinleck. The British prevented a second advance by the Axis forces into Egypt. Axis positions near El Alamein, only from Alexandria, were dangerously close to the ports and cities of Egypt, the base facilities of the Commonwealth forces and the Suez Canal. However, the Axis forces were too far from their base at Tripoli in Libya to remain at El Alamein indefinitely, which led both sides to accumulate supplies for more offensives, against the constraints of time and distance. Following their defeat at the Battle of Gazala in eastern Libya in June 1942, the British 8th Army, commanded by Lieutenant General Neil Ritchie, had retreated east from the Gazala line into northwestern Egypt as far as Mersa Matruh, roughly inside the border. Ritchie had decided not to hold the defense in the Egyptian border, because the defensive plan there was for infantry to hold defended localities and a strong armored force behind them to meet any attempts to penetrate or outflank the fixed defenses. Since General Ritchie had virtually no armored units left fit to fight, the infantry positions would be defeated in detail. The Mersa defense plan also included an armored reserve, but in its absence Ritchie believed he could organize his infantry to cover the minefields between the defended localities to prevent Axis engineers from having undisturbed access. To defend the Matruh line, Ritchie placed 10th Indian Infantry Division, in Matruh itself, and 50th, Northumbrian, Infantry Division, some down the coast at Jirala, under X Corps HQ, newly arrived from Syria. Inland from X Corps would be 13th Corps with 5th Indian Infantry Division, with only one infantry brigade, 29th Indian, and two artillery regiments, around Sidi Hamza about inland, and the newly arrived 2nd New Zealand Division, short one brigade, the 6th, which had been left out of combat in case the division was captured and it would be needed to serve as the nucleus of a new division, at Minkarkaim on the escarpment inland, and 1st Armored Division in the open desert to the south. The 1st Armored Division had taken over 4th and 22nd Armored Brigades from 7th Armored Division, which by this time had only three tank regiments, battalions, between them. On 25th of June, General Claude Auchinleck, Commander-in-Chief, CNC, Middle East Command, relieved Ritchie and assumed direct command of the 8th Army himself. He decided not to seek a decisive confrontation at the Mersa Matruh position. He concluded that his inferiority in armor after the Gazala defeat meant he would be unable to prevent Rommel either breaking through his center or enveloping his open left flank to the south in the same way he had at Gazala. He decided instead to employ delaying tactics while withdrawing a further or more east to a more defensible position near El Alamein on the Mediterranean coast. Only to the south of El Alamein, the steep slopes of the Qadira Depression ruled out the possibility of Axis armor moving around the southern flank of his defenses and limited the width of the front he had to defend. While preparing the Alamein positions, Auchinleck fought strong delaying actions, first at Mersa Matruh on 26-27 June and then Fuqa on 28 June. The late change of orders resulted in some confusion in the forward formations, X Corps and 13th Corps, between the desire to inflict damage on the enemy and the intention not to get trapped in the Matruh position but retreat in good order. The result was poor coordination between the two forward corps and units within them. Late on 26 June, the 90th Light and 21st Panzer Divisions managed to find their way through the minefields in the center of the front. Early on 27 June, resuming its advance, the 90th Light was checked by British 50th Division's artillery. Meanwhile, the 15th and 21st Panzer Divisions advanced east above and below the escarpment. The 15th Panzer were blocked by 4th Armored and 7th Motor Brigades, but the 21st Panzer were ordered on to attack Minkarkaim. Rommel ordered 90th Light to resume its advance, requiring it to cut the coast road behind 50th Division by the evening. As the 21st Panzer moved on Minkarkaim, the 2nd New Zealand Division found itself surrounded but broke out on the night of 27-28 of June without serious losses and withdrew east. Auchinleck had planned a second delaying position at Fuqa, some east of Matruh, and at 21:20 he issued the orders for a withdrawal to Fuqa. Confusion in communication led the division withdrawing immediately to the El Alamein position. X Corps, having made an unsuccessful attempt to secure a position on the escarpment, were out of touch with 8th Army from 19:30 until 4:30 the next morning. Only then did they discover that the withdrawal order had been given. The withdrawal of 13th Corps had left the southern flank of X Corps on the coast at Matruh exposed and their line of retreat compromised by the cutting of the coastal road east of Matruh. They were ordered to break out southwards into the desert and then make their way east. Auchinleck ordered 13th Corps to provide support, but they were in no position to do so. At 2100 hours on 28th of June, X Corps, organized into brigade groups, headed south. In the darkness, there was considerable confusion as they came across enemy units lagered for the night. In the process, 5th Indian Division in particular sustained heavy casualties, including the destruction of the 29th Indian Infantry Brigade at Fuka. Axis forces captured more than 6,000 prisoners, in addition to 40 tanks and an enormous quantity of supplies. Alamein itself was an inconsequential railway station on the coast. Some to the south lay the Ruwaysat Ridge, a low stony prominence that gave excellent observation for many miles over the surrounding desert. To the south was the Kotara Depression. The line the British chose to defend stretched between the sea and the depression, which meant that Rommel could outflank it only by taking a significant detour to the south and crossing the Sahara Desert. The British Army in Egypt recognized this before the war and had the 8th Army begin construction of several boxes, localities with dugouts and surrounded by minefields and barbed wire, the most developed being around the railway station at Alamein. Most of the line was open, empty desert. Lieutenant General William Norrie, General Officer Commanding, GOC 30 Corps, organized the position and started to construct three defended boxes. The first and strongest, at El Alamein on the coast, had been partly wired and mined by 1st South African Division. The Bab El Kotara box, some from the coast and southwest of the Ruwaysat Ridge, had been dug but had not been wired or mined, while at the Nok Abu Dwais box, on the edge of the Kotara Depression, from the coast, very little work had been done. The British position in Egypt was desperate. The rout from Mersa Matruh had created a panic in the British headquarters at Cairo, something later called the flap. On what came to be referred to as Ash Wednesday, at British headquarters, rear echelon units and the British embassy, papers were hurriedly burned in anticipation of the fall of the city. Auchinleck, although believing he could stop Rommel at Alamein, felt he could not ignore the possibility that he might once more be outmaneuvered or outfought. To maintain his army, plans must be made for the possibility of a further retreat whilst maintaining morale and retaining the support and cooperation of the Egyptians. Defensive positions were constructed west of Alexandria and on the approaches to Cairo, while considerable areas in the Nile Delta were flooded. The Axis, too, believed that the capture of Egypt was imminent. Italian leader Benito Mussolini, sensing a historic moment, flew to Libya to prepare for his triumphal entry into Cairo. The scattering of X Corps at Mersa Matruh disrupted Auchinleck's plan for occupying the Alamein defenses. On 29 June, he ordered 30 Corps, the 1st South African, 5th and 10th Indian Divisions, to take the coastal sector on the right of the front, and 13 Corps, the 2nd New Zealand Division and 4th Indian Divisions, to be on the left. The remains of the 1st Armored Division and the 7th Armored Division were to be held as a mobile army reserve. His intention was for the fixed defensive positions to channel and disorganize the enemy's advance while mobile units would attack their flanks and rear. On 30 June, Rommel's Panzer Army Africa approached the Alamein position. The Axis forces were exhausted and understrength. Rommel had driven them forward ruthlessly, being confident that, provided he struck quickly before 8th Army had time to settle, his momentum would take him through the Alamein position and he could then advance to the Nile with little further opposition. Supplies remained a problem because the Axis staff had originally expected a pause of 6 weeks after the capture of Tobruk. German air units were also exhausted and providing little help against the RAF's all-out attack on the Axis supply lines, which, with the arrival of United States Army Air Forces, USAF, heavy bombers, could reach as far as Benghazi. Although captured supplies proved useful, water and ammunition were constantly in short supply, while a shortage of transport impeded the distribution of supplies that the Axis forces did have. Rommel's plan was for the 90th Light Division and the 15th and 21st Panzer Divisions of the Africa Corps to penetrate the 8th Army lines between the Alamein Box and Deir el-Abiad, which he believed was defended. The 90th Light Division was then to veer north to cut the coastal road and trap the defenders off the Alamein Box, which Rommel thought was occupied by the remains of the 50th Infantry Division, and the Africa Corps would veer right to attack their heir of 13 Corps. An Italian division was to attack the Alamein Box from the west and another was to follow the 90th Light Division. The Italian 20th Corps was to follow the Africa Corps and deal with the Cottara Box, while the 133rd Armored Division, Littorio and German reconnaissance units would protect the right flank. Rommel had planned to attack on 30th of June, but supply and transport difficulties had resulted in a day's delay, vital to the defending forces reorganizing on the Alamein line. On 30th of June, the 90th Light Division was still short of its start line, 21st Panzer Division was immobilized through lack of fuel, and the promised air support had yet to move into its advanced airfields. At 3 o'clock on 1st of July, 90th Light Infantry Division advanced east but strayed too far north and ran into the 1st South African Division's defenses and became pinned down. The 15th and 21st Panzer Divisions of the Africa Corps were delayed by a sandstorm and then a heavy air attack. It was broad daylight by the time they circled round the back of Deir el Abiad, where they found the feature to the east of it occupied by 18th Indian Infantry Brigade, which, after a hasty journey from Iraq, had occupied the exposed position just west of Ruwaysat Ridge and east of Deir el Abiad at Deir el Shine Ladi on 28th of June to create one of Nouri's additional defensive boxes. At about 10 o'clock on 1st of July, 21st Panzer Division attacked Deir el Shine. 18th Indian Infantry Brigade, supported by 23 25-pounder gun howitzers, 16 of the new 6-pounder anti-tank guns and 9 Matilda tanks, held out the whole day in desperate fighting, but by evening the Germans succeeded in overrunning them. The time they bought allowed Auchinleck to organize the defense of the western end of Ruwaysat Ridge. The 1st Armored Division had been sent to intervene at Deir el Shine. They ran into 15th Panzer Division just south of Deir el Shine and drove it west. By the end of the day's fighting, the Africa Corps had 37 tanks left out of its initial complement of 55. During the early afternoon, 90th Light had extricated itself from the Al Alamein Box defenses and resumed its move eastward. It came under artillery fire from the 3 South African Brigade groups and was forced to dig in. On 2nd of July, Rommel ordered the resumption of the offensive. Once again, 90th Light failed to make progress, so Rommel called the Africa Corps to abandon its planned sweep southward and instead join the effort to break through to the coast road by attacking east toward Ruwaysat Ridge. The British defense of Ruwaysat Ridge relied on an improvised formation called Robcal, comprising a regiment each of field artillery and light anti-aircraft artillery in a company of infantry. Robcal, in line with normal British Army practice for ad hoc formations, was named after its commander, Brigadier Robert Waller, the Commander Royal Artillery of the 10th Indian Infantry Division. Robcal was able to buy time, and by late afternoon the two British Armored Brigades joined the battle, with 4th Armored Brigade engaging 15th Panzer and 22nd Armored Brigade 21st Panzer respectively. They drove back repeated attacks by the Axis armor, who then withdrew before dusk. The British reinforced Ruwaysat on the night of 2nd of July. The now enlarged Robcal became Wall Group. Meanwhile, the Royal Air Force, RAF, made heavy air attacks on the Axis units. The next day, 3rd of July, Rommel ordered the Africa Corps to resume its attack on the Ruwaysat Ridge with the Italian 20 Motorized Corps on its southern flank. Italian X Corps, meanwhile, were to hold Elm Rear. By this stage the Africa Corps had only 26 operational tanks. There was a sharp armored exchange south of Ruwaysat Ridge during the morning and the main Axis advance was held. On 3rd of July, the RAF flew 780 sorties to relieve the pressure on the right and center of the 8th Army line. 13th Corps on the left advanced from the Cottara Box, known to the New Zealanders as Kapanga Box. The plan was that the New Zealand 2nd Division, with the remains of Indian 5th Division and 7th Motor Brigade under its command, would swing north to threaten the Axis flank and rear. This force encountered the RAF Armored Division's artillery, which was driving on the southern flank of the division as it attacked Ruwaysat. The Italian commander ordered his battalions to fight their way out independently, but the riot lost 531 men, about 350 were prisoners, 36 pieces of artillery, 6, or 8, tanks, and 55 trucks. By the end of the day, the riot division had only 5 tanks. The day ended once again with the Africa Corps and riot coming off second best to the superior numbers of the British 22nd Armored and 4th Armored Brigades, frustrating Rommel's attempts to resume his advance. The RAF once again played its part, flying 900 sorties during the day. To the south, on 5th of July, the New Zealand group resumed its advance northwards towards Elm Rear, intending to cut the rear of the Riot Division. Heavy fire from the Italian Brescia Motorized Division at Elm Rear, however, north of the Cottara Box, checked their progress and led 13 Corps to call off Eat's attack. At this point, Rommel decided his exhausted forces could make no further headway without resting and regrouping. He reported to the German High Command that his three German divisions numbered just 1,200 to 1,500 men each, and resupply was proving highly problematic because of enemy interference from the air. He expected to have to remain on the defensive for at least 2 weeks. Rommel was by this time suffering from the extended length of his supply lines. The Allied Desert Air Force, DAF, was concentrating fiercely on his fragile and elongated supply routes, while British mobile columns moving west and striking from the south were causing havoc in the Axis rear echelons. Rommel could afford these losses even less, since shipments from Italy had been substantially reduced. In June, he received of supplies compared with in May and 400 vehicles, compared with 2,000 in May. Meanwhile, the 8th Army was reorganizing and rebuilding, benefiting from its short lines of communication. By 4th of July, the Australian 9th Division had entered the line in the north, and on 9th of July the Indian 5th Infantry Brigade also returned, taking over the Rouaisat position. At the same time, the fresh Indian 161st Infantry Brigade reinforced the depleted Indian 5th Infantry Division. On 8th of July, Auchinleck ordered the new 30 Corps commander, Lieutenant General William Ramsden, to capture the low ridges at Tel El Asa and Tel El Makhad, and then to push mobile battle groups south toward Deir el-Shine and raiding parties west toward the airfields at El Daba. Meanwhile, 13 Corps would prevent the Axis from moving troops north to reinforce the coastal sector. Ramsden tasked the Australian 9th Division with 44th Royal Tank Regiment under command with the Tel El Asa objective, and the South African 1st Division with 8 supporting tanks, Tel El Makhad. The raiding parties were to be provided by 1st Armoured Division. Following a bombardment which started at 3:30 on 10th of July, the Australian 26th Brigade launched an attack against the ridge north of Tel El Asa station along the coast, Trig 33. The bombardment was the heaviest barrage yet experienced in North Africa, which created panic in the inexperienced soldiers of the Italian 60th Infantry Division Sabrata, who had only just occupied sketchy defences in the sector. The Australian attack took more than 1,500 prisoners, routed an Italian division and overran the German Signals Intercept Company 621. Meanwhile, the South Africans had by late morning taken Tel El Makhad and were in covering positions. Elements of the German 164th Light Division and Italian 101st Motorized Division Trieste arrived to plug the gap torn in the Axis defences. That afternoon and evening, tanks from the German 15th Panzer and Italian Trieste divisions launched counterattacks against the Australian positions, the counterattacks failing in the face of overwhelming Allied artillery and the Australian anti-tank guns. At first light on 11th of July, the Australian 224th Battalion, supported by tanks from 44th Royal Tank Regiment, attacked the western end of Tel El Asa Hill, Point 24. By early afternoon, the feature was captured and was then held against a series of Axis counterattacks throughout the day. A small column of armour, motorised infantry, and guns then set off to raid Deir el-Abiad and caused a battalion of Italian infantry to surrender. Its progress was checked at the Maitiria Ridge and it was forced to withdraw that evening to the El Alamein Box. During the day, more than 1,000 Italian prisoners were taken. On 12th of July, the 21st Panzer Division launched a counterattack against Trig 33 and Point 24, which was beaten off after a 2.5-hour fight, with more than 600 German dead and wounded left strewn in front of the Australian positions. The next day, 21st Panzer Division launched an attack against Point 33 and South African positions in the El Alamein Box. The attack was halted by intense artillery fire from the defenders. Rommel was still determined to drive the British forces from the northern salient. Although the Australian defenders had been forced back from Point 24, heavy casualties had been inflicted on 21st Panzer Division. Another attack was mounted on 15th of July but made no ground against tenacious resistance. On 16th of July, the Australians, supported by British tanks, launched an attack to try to take Point 24 but were forced back by German counterattacks, suffering nearly 50% casualties. After 7 days of fierce fighting, the battle in the north for Tel El Asa salient petered out. Australian 9th Division estimated at least 2,000 Axis troops had been killed and more than 3,700 prisoners of war taken in the battle. Possibly the most important feature of the battle, however, was that the Australians had captured Signals Intercept Company 621. This unit had provided Rommel with priceless intelligence, gleaned from intercepting British radio communications. That source of intelligence was now lost to Rommel. As the Axis forces dug in, Auchinleck, having drawn a number of German units to the coastal sector during the Tel Alesa fighting, developed a plan, codenamed Operation Bacon, to attack the Italian Pavia and Brescia divisions in the center of the front at the Ruwaiset Ridge. Signals intelligence was giving Auchinleck clear details of the Axis order of battle and force dispositions. His policy was to hit the Italians wherever possible in view of their low morale and because the Germans cannot hold extended fronts without them. The intention was for the 4th New Zealand Brigade and 5th New Zealand Brigade, on 4th Brigade's right, to attack northwest to seize the western part of the ridge and on their right the Indian 5th Infantry Brigade to capture the eastern part of the ridge in a night attack. Then 2nd Armoured Brigade would pass through the center of the infantry objectives to exploit toward Deir el-Shine and the Mitiria Ridge. On the left, the 22nd Armoured Brigade would be ready to move forward to protect the infantry as they consolidated on the ridge. The attack commenced at 2300 hours on 14th of July. The two New Zealand brigades shortly before dawn on 15th of July took their objectives, but minefields and pockets of resistance created disarray among the attackers. A number of pockets of resistance were left behind the forward troops' advance which impeded the move forward of reserves, artillery, and support arms. As a result, the New Zealand brigades occupied exposed positions on the ridge without support weapons except for a few anti-tank guns. More significantly, communications with the two British armoured brigades failed, and the British armour did not move forward to protect the infantry. At first light, a detachment from 15th Panzer Division's 8th Panzer Regiment launched a counterattack against New Zealand 4th Brigade's 22nd Battalion. A sharp exchange knocked out their anti-tank guns and the infantry found themselves exposed in the open with no alternative but to surrender. About 350 New Zealanders were taken prisoner. While the 2nd New Zealand Division attacked the western slopes of Ruwaiset Ridge, the Indian 5th Brigade made small gains on Ruwaiset Ridge to the east. By 7 o'clock, word was finally got to 2nd Armoured Brigade which started to move northwest. Two regiments became embroiled in a minefield but the 3rd was able to join Indian 5th Infantry 5th Brigade as it renewed its attack. With the help of the armour and artillery, the Indians were able to take their objectives by early afternoon. Meanwhile, the 22nd Armoured Brigade had been engaged at Alumni by 90th Light Division and the Arriet Armoured Division, advancing from the south. While, with help from mobile infantry and artillery columns from 7th Armoured Division, they pushed back the Axis probe with ease, they were prevented from advancing north to protect the New Zealand flank. Seeing the Brescia and Pavia under pressure, Rommel rushed German troops to Ruwaiset. By 1500 hours, the 3rd Reconnaissance Regiment and part of 21st Panzer Division from the north and 33rd Reconnaissance Regiment and the Bod Group comprising elements from 15th Panzer Division from the south were in place under Lieutenant General, General der Panzertrupp, Walter Nering. At 1700 hours, Nering launched his counterattack. 4th New Zealand Brigade were still short of support weapons and also, by this time, ammunition. Once again, the anti-tank defenses were overwhelmed and about 380 New Zealanders were taken prisoner including Captain Charles Upham who gained a 2nd Victoria Cross for his actions including destroying a German tank and several guns and vehicles with grenades despite being shot through the elbow by a machine gun bullet and having his arm broken. At about 1800 hours, the brigade HQ was overrun. At about 1815, 2nd Armoured Brigade engaged the German armour and halted the Axis eastward advance. At dusk, Nering broke off the action. Early on 16th of July, Nering renewed his attack. The 5th Indian Infantry Brigade pushed them back but it was clear from intercepted radio traffic that a further attempt would be made. Strenuous preparations to dig in anti-tank guns were made, artillery fire plans organized and a regiment from the 22nd Armored Brigade was sent to reinforce the 2nd Armored Brigade. When the attack resumed late in the afternoon, it was repulsed. After the battle, the Indians counted 24 knocked-out tanks, as well as armored cars and numerous anti-tank guns left on the battlefield. In 3 days' fighting, the Allies took more than 2,000 Axis prisoners, mostly from the Italian Brescia and Pavia divisions. The New Zealand division suffered 1,405 casualties. The fighting at Tel Alesa and Ruwaiset had caused the destruction of 3 Italian divisions, forced Rommel to redeploy his armor from the south, made it necessary to lay minefields in front of the remaining Italian divisions and stiffen them with detachments of German troops. To relieve pressure on Ruwaiset Ridge, Auchinleck ordered the Australian 9th Division to make another attack from the north. In the early hours of 27th of July, The Australian 24th Brigade, supported by 44th Royal Tank Regiment, RTR, and strong fighter cover from the air, assaulted Mytir Yaraj, known as Ruin Ridge to the Australians. The initial night attack went well, with 736 prisoners taken, mostly from the Italian Trento and Trieste motorized divisions. Once again, however, a critical situation for the Axis forces was retrieved by vigorous counterattacks from hastily assembled German and Italian forces, which forced the Australians to withdraw back to their start line with 300 casualties. Although the Australian official history of the 24th Brigade's 232nd Battalion describes the counterattack force as German, the Australian historian Mark Johnston reports that German records indicate that it was the Trento Division that overran the Australian battalion. The 8th Army now enjoyed a massive superiority in material over the Axis forces. 1st Armoured Division had 173 tanks and more in reserve or in transit, including 61 Grants, while Rommel possessed only 38 German tanks and 51 Italian tanks, although his armoured units had some 100 tanks awaiting repair. Auchinleck's plan was for Indian Infantry 161st Brigade to attack along Ruwaysat Ridge to take Deir el-Shine, while the New Zealand 6th Brigade attacked from south of the ridge to the Elmrere Depression. At daylight, two British armoured brigades, 2nd Armoured Brigade and the fresh 23rd Armoured Brigade, would sweep through the gap created by the infantry. The plan was complicated and ambitious. The infantry night attack began at 16:30 on 21st of July. The New Zealand attack took their objectives in the Elmrere Depression but, once again, many vehicles failed to arrive and they were short of support arms in an exposed position. At daybreak on 22nd of July, the British armoured brigades again failed to advance. At daybreak on 22nd of July, Nering's 5th and 8th Panzer Regiments responded with a rapid counterattack which quickly overran the New Zealand infantry in the open, inflicting more than 900 casualties on the New Zealanders. 2nd Armoured Brigade sent forward two regiments to help but they were halted by mines and anti-tank fire. The attack by Indian 161st Brigade had mixed fortunes. On the left, the initial attempt to clear the western end of Ruwaysat failed but at 8 o'clock a renewed attack by the reserve battalion succeeded. On the right, the attacking battalion broke into the Deir el-Shine position but was driven back in hand-to-hand fighting. Compounding the disaster at Elmrere, at 8 o'clock the commander of 23rd Armoured Brigade ordered his brigade forward, intent on following his orders to the letter. Major General Gatehouse, commanding 1st Armoured Division, had been unconvinced that a path had been adequately cleared in the minefields and had suggested the advance be cancelled. However, 13th Corps Commander, Lieutenant General William Gott, rejected this and ordered the attack but on a center line south of the original plan which he incorrectly believed was mine-free. These orders failed to get through and the attack went ahead as originally planned. The brigade found itself mired in minefields and under heavy fire. They were then counterattacked by 21st Panzer at 11 o'clock and forced to withdraw. The 23rd Armoured Brigade was destroyed, with a loss of 40 tanks destroyed and 47 badly damaged. At 1700 hours, Gott ordered 5th Indian Infantry Division to execute a night attack to capture the western half of Ruwaysat Ridge and Deir el-Shine. 314th Punjab Regiment from 9th Indian Infantry Brigade attacked at 2 o'clock on 23rd of July but failed as they lost their direction. A further attempt in daylight succeeded in breaking into the position but intense fire from three sides resulted in control being lost as the commanding officer was killed, and four of his senior officers were wounded or went missing. To the north, Australian 9th Division continued its attacks. At 6 o'clock on 22nd of July, Australian 26th Brigade attacked Tel el-Aissa and Australian 24th Brigade attacked Tel el-Makkad toward Mytiria, Ruin Ridge. It was during this fighting that Arthur Stanley Gurney performed the actions for which he was posthumously awarded the Victoria Cross. The fighting for Tel el-Aissa was costly, but by the afternoon the Australians controlled the feature. That evening, Australian 24th Brigade attacked Tel el-Makkad with the tanks of 50th RTR in support. The tank unit had not been trained in close infantry support and failed to coordinate with the Australian infantry. The result was that the infantry and armour advanced independently and having reached the objective 50th RTR lost 23 tanks because they lacked infantry support. Once more, the 8th Army had failed to destroy Rommel's forces, despite its overwhelming superiority in men and equipment. On the other hand, for Rommel the situation continued to be grave as, despite successful defensive operations, his infantry had suffered heavy losses and he reported that the situation is critical in the extreme. On 26-27 July, Auchinleck launched Operation Manhood in the northern sector in a final attempt to break the Axis forces. Triple X Corps was reinforced with 1st Armored Division, Les 22nd Armored Brigade, 4th Light Armored Brigade, and 69th Infantry Brigade. The plan was to break the enemy line south of Mitiria Ridge and exploit northwest. The South Africans were to make and mark a gap in the minefields to the southeast of Mitiria by midnight of 26-27 July. By 1 o'clock on 27 July, 24th Australian Infantry Brigade was to have captured the eastern end of the Mitiria Ridge and would exploit toward the northwest. The 69th Infantry Brigade would pass through the minefield gap created by the South Africans to Deir al-Dabban clear and mark gaps in further minefields. The 2nd Armored Brigade would then pass through to Elwishka and would be followed by 4th Light Armored Brigade, which would attack the Axis lines of communication. This was the third attempt to break through in the northern sector, and the Axis defenders were expecting the attack. Like the previous attacks, it was hurriedly and therefore poorly planned. The Australian 24th Brigade managed to take their objectives on Mitiria Ridge by 02:00 of 27 July. To the south, the British 69th Brigade set off at 1:30 and managed to take their objectives by about 08:00. However, the supporting anti-tank units became lost in the darkness or delayed by minefields, leaving the attackers isolated and exposed when daylight came. There followed a period during which reports from the battlefront regarding the minefield gaps were confused and conflicting. As a consequence, the advance of 2nd Armored Brigade was delayed. Rommel launched an immediate counter-attack and the German armored battlegroups overran the two forward battalions of 69th Brigade. Meanwhile, 50th Artillery supporting the Australians was having difficulty locating the minefield gaps mad by Australian 224th Battalion. They failed to find a route through and in the process were caught by heavy fire and lost 13 tanks. The unsupported 228th Australian Battalion on the ridge was overrun. The 69th Brigade suffered 600 casualties and the Australians 400 for no gain. The 8th Army was exhausted, and on 31 July Auchinleck ordered an end to offensive operations and the strengthening of the defences to meet a major counter-offensive. Rommel was later to blame the failure to break through to the Nile on how the sources of supply to his army had dried up and how Rommel complained bitterly about the failure of important Italian convoys to get through to him desperately needed tanks and supplies, always blaming the Italian Supreme Command, never suspecting British code-breaking. According to Dr. James Sadkovich and others, Rommel often displayed a distinct tendency to blame and scapegoat his Italian allies to cover up his own mistakes and deficiencies as a commander in the field. For example, while Rommel was a very good tactical commander, the Italian and German high commands were concerned that he lacked operational awareness and a sense of strategic objectives. Dr. Sadkovich points out that he would often outrun his logistics and squander valuable, mostly Italian, military hardware and resources in battle after battle without clear strategic goals and an appreciation of the limited logistics his Italian allies were desperately trying to provide him. The battle was a stalemate, but it had halted the Axis advance on Alexandria, and then Cairo and ultimately the Suez Canal. The 8th Army had suffered over 13,000 casualties in July, including 4,000 in the 2nd New Zealand Division, 3,000 in the 5th Indian Infantry Division and 2,552 battle casualties in the 9th Australian Division, but had taken 7,000 prisoners and inflicted heavy damage on Axis men and machines. In his appreciation of 27th of July, Auchinleck wrote that the 8th Army would not be ready to attack again until mid-September at the earliest. He believed that because Rommel understood that with the passage of time the Allied situation would only improve, he was compelled to attack as soon as possible and before the end of August when he would have superiority in armor. Auchinleck therefore made plans for a defensive battle. In early August, Winston Churchill and General Sir Alan Brooke, the chief of the Imperial General Staff, CIGS, visited Cairo on their way to meet Joseph Stalin in Moscow. They decided to replace Auchinleck, appointing the 13th Corps commander, William Gott, to the 8th Army Command and General Sir Harold Alexander as CNC Middle East Command. Persia and Iraq were to be split from Middle East Command as a separate Persia and Iraq Command, and Auchinleck was offered the post of CNC, which he refused. Gott was killed on the way to take up his command when his aircraft was shot down. Lieutenant General Bernard Montgomery was appointed in his place and took command on 13th of August. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.